Welcome back and thank you for visiting my YouTube channel. My name is Terrence Williams and I'm a student of the word of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, being obedient to what I believe the Holy Spirit is leading me to do. Thank you once again for joining me. The title of this video is called Rushing to Get Where? To Worldly Privilege? To Be Unequally Yoked. Today we will start off by looking at some verses in Isaiah 17, verse 12 through 13. Woe to the multitude of many people, which make a noise like the noise of the seas, and to the rushing of nations, that make a rushing like the rushing of mighty waters. The nations shall rush like the rushing of many waters, but God shall rebuke them, and they shall flee far off, and shall be chased as the chaff of the mountains before the wind, and like a rolling thing before the whirlwind. In this scripture, when the prophet Isaiah mentioned many people, he was speaking about the armies of Judah's enemies coming against them, and he was issuing out a warning. He used the noise of the seas and the rushing of mighty waters to describe the sound that the armies would make as they rushed into battle. If you have ever stood near the ocean, the noise of the sea and the rushing of mighty waters is truly a loud, strong, powerful sound. Consider the sound of whitewater rapids, or the sound of a large waterfall, and imagine standing near it. These days, you can search for the sound on YouTube and get a pretty good idea that these armies would sound like this because there would be so many. Isaiah put out a warning by saying, "Woe to them," because even though they would be many, God would have the victory. No matter how many there were and what they sounded like, they were going to flee and be chased away. Even though this is speaking about armies, battles, and enemies, I can't help but to see another meaning in it, because people today are rushing like these armies. The mass amount of people alive today sound like the rushing of the seas and mighty waters as we run here and run there, always in a hurry. It doesn't take much to see that people in the world are rushing to get somewhere. But the question is, rushing to get where? I'm sure that what I'm about to say happens to everyone and probably more than once a day. Now, as I was traveling south on a four-lane road divided by a center turn lane, there were gas stations, restaurants, convenience stores on both sides of the road, and a small shopping mall on the right. I was in the left lane coming up on a major intersection where cars enter and exit Interstate 20. It's Saturday and it's pretty busy. Even though there are two lanes of cars on my right, one of which the drivers are trying to get onto the interstate going west, someone comes from my left from one of the establishments and decides to creep across the first two lanes of oncoming traffic into the center turn lane, cross in front of me. Mind you, that was while I was still approaching the intersection. Crosses in front of the cars in the lane to my right and in front of the cars that are already trying to get onto the interstate. Now, I don't remember making eye contact to signal that I was cool with that. But as I anticipate what was going through their minds, I imagine they were saying, "It's Saturday, this is a lot of traffic, and I'm going to shoot across five lanes and get on that interstate if it's the last thing I do." The thing is, it could have very well been the last thing they did. The choice they made in a moment of rushing and anxiousness could have ended their life, and all for what? Rushing to get where? The world is in a hurry to get nowhere. The sad state of things is that most of the world, even some inside the church, are the part of civilization that is rushing to their own destruction, because the things that people are trying to get to are most of the things of the world. Right fellowship with God and the Word of God being their guide is the furthest thing from their minds. If they are rushing to the things of this world, then they are rushing to accept false teachings and follow false gods. Take the scripture and apply it to life today, and the woe might very well pertain to us, not being so puffed up in our vain pursuit of worldly pleasures. The woe could be for people to rush toward God, because rushing away from Him only leads to defeat. Rushing away from God causes you to become an enemy that is rebuked, disapproved of, because of behavior and actions that are not like God. He says enemies will flee and be chased away in victory. So I figure it's far better to be on the side of victory than to compromise with the ways of the world and be on the side of defeat. In the end, the sound of defeat only leads to a lake of fire and brimstone. But let's say you do decide to continue to rush toward the things of this world. What will you do to keep your worldly privileges? This situation actually happened to a kid in school who loves to talk and play in the halls. They kept getting negative marks for those actions and positive marks for their exceptional work and participation in the classroom. It's kind of confusing. Despite the negative marks, the actions that led to them continued, ultimately resulting in punishment. The punishment? The kid will not be able to wear their Halloween costume to school during the month of October. Now let's be real for a minute. The incentive for being good is to strip away a privilege to be a part of a worldly event that celebrates a day set apart for remembering the dead, a day that originated from the Celtic Harvest Festival, which was celebrated between October 31st and November 1st by Celtic religious priests known as Druids. The Druids were known for having familiar spirits or demons. Devils were all priests of Baal, the sun god, also known as Nimrod, and they practiced witchcraft during this time and spoke with devils or demons, asking them for favors. They talked to the dead, used demons to cast spells. This pagan festival time was also known by another term called Samhain. It was a time for Druid priests to worship their pagan deity, gods, fairies, spirits, and disemboweled demons. There were customs like bobbing for apples. If you ever wonder where that came from, that's where. They would burn bonfires to keep the dead away. They would practice trick-or-treat. Sound familiar? Trick-or-treat back then to the Druids was where dead spirits went door-to-door. So the Druids picked up that practice and they went door-to-door tricking or treating the inhabitants of the homes. A jack-o'-lantern for them was actually a hollowed-out turnip with candles to light. They also dressed up in costumes. And when the Roman Catholic Church took power, they kept this pagan festival to make Christianity more appealing to the pagans. Basically, not much has changed. Halloween today is an adapted version of the pagan traditions of the Druid priests. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying celebrate or not celebrate. I just use that as an example, and that's not what this video is about. You can read through the Bible and find scriptures that are against it, even though you won't find the word Halloween, because the name comes from an old English word, hallowed, meaning holy or sanctified, and the name came together into a more familiar word known as Halloween, or All Hallows Eve, or the day before All Hallows Day, or All Saints Day. Now here's a list of scriptures . Now those were the ones that would be more against it, and here are some that aren't necessarily for it, but still more toward your choice and your conscience. So, work out your own salvation. All I'm simply saying is, in this video, is that this is the kind of false teachings that are taught in the world today. Be good or your worldly privilege will be taken away. It's sad, but the same thing has been happening for the last couple of years as more and more of our privileges have been threatened, restricted, or just plain taken away if people refuse to comply with you know what. It's getting to the point where even things that aren't considered worldly, things everyone should be entitled to do, like eat, work, receive health care, or lumped into compromise with you know what. Will we be good just because being good is good for us to do? Or will our goodness be connected to a compromise so we can continue to rush toward our worldly privileges to keep them from getting stripped away? Most of these worldly privileges only keep us yoked together with a world of unbelievers anyway. 2 Corinthians 6:14 tells us to be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? The scripture is not telling us that we can't establish rapport with those that are lost, the unbeliever, the unrighteous, and those still in darkness. If an unbeliever is comfortable enough with us to have a conversation about beliefs, there's a better chance that something they hear or something they see in us as we witness to them will begin to stir up their spirit and allow them to open up enough for God to draw them to salvation. Now, the scripture is telling us not to get involved in their way of life. The longer a believer associates with an unbeliever in their territory, the world, the better chance it is that the things that come with their lifestyle will rub off on us. It's just strange that way. Bad rubs off on good more than good rubs off on bad. So it could mean that as a believer, if we see a situation on the horizon where we might turn away from our belief toward that of an unbeliever, as Snagglepuss the cartoon character would put it, heavens to Murgatroyd, exit stage left. Get out of that situation, because we as believers are not to be bound together with non-Christians in any spiritual enterprise or relationship that would be detrimental to the Christian's testimony within the body of Christ. But it also doesn't mean end all associations with unbelievers, because that would go against the purpose why we are saved and still here on earth with the charge to spread the gospel to as many as we can. So again, rushing to where? Don't rush toward your destruction. Rush toward God. Don't rush to compromise with the world to keep your worldly privileges. Set your minds on things above and not on things below. Don't rush to be involved in the way of life of this unbelieving world and remain there until it rubs off on you. Rush to the world with the mind of Christ so that we can rub off on them and they can be saved. Rush to establish rapport so that the conversation can be had, so that we can introduce people to Jesus and plant a small seed of doubt in the current lifestyle they enjoy, so the Holy Spirit can do the rest and bring people to salvation. And if you find yourself tempted, battle it with the Word of God or exit that situation quickly. Again, thank you for viewing this video, and I look forward to posting more as the Holy Spirit leads me to. Remember, Hebrews 3:13, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Make use of today, because there may not be a tomorrow. These are distressing times, and more perilous times will come that might tempt us to return to a worldly system that is ineffective. Encourage each other to continue to trust in Jesus Christ, so that none of us rejects the gospel, hardens our hearts, and become antichrist through the lies and deception of this world. Don't put off salvation. It might be the last opportunity. Be encouraged, and remember to like and share this video and subscribe to my YouTube channel. Thank you.